this morning. Dear Lord Jesus, we come before you and we thank you for this morning. We come expecting, Lord Jesus, and we thank you for being here now in this place. Oh, Lord Jesus, don't let us take this time for granted. Let our offering of worship, Lord Jesus, just be a time, Lord, where it's sweet and acceptable and pleasing to you, Lord. We thank you for what you've done in our lives and what you will continue to do, Lord Jesus. In your awesome name we pray. Amen.
This is how I know what love is. This is how I know I'm free. This is how I know salvation. Jesus came and he died for me. I come to worship. This is why I lift my hands. This is why I now surrender everything I am. Because of your love. Dancing in my heart. and your blood that washes us clean.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again?
Nothing but the blood of
joy.
is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory.
The earth is filled.
The earth is filled with His glory.
The earth is filled with His glory.
You know, I wanted to just take a moment, and as we continue to enter into worship, I want to just let you know that these altars are open. The altars are open for you to come and to do a great exchange. Your weakness for His strength, your heaviness for His yoke, which is easy and light. And I've been studying the history of revivals that have happened throughout the centuries. And even, so sorry guys, we're not taking the offering right now, but I don't want to get you all the way down here. Sorry. I've been studying the history of revivals as they've come through the centuries. And something occurs in the life of the church, meaning the body of Christ, where after a season maybe of dry times, people begin to revolt against that dryness, so to speak. They rise up and they say, there's got to be something more of God. There has to be something more. And it isn't just this way, but oftentimes it comes through students and young people. This is consistent from the 16th century, 17th century, 18th century, that young people, 15, 14, 13, 16, 17, into their college years, began to go back into the scriptures and say, what would it be like if we all got together and began to read this book together and pray together and then trust God to move in our midst? And then God stirs something, revival fire kindles, and then it begins to spark into a flame, and then it spills out. And God has a tendency to use the least likely people sometimes to do His work. And I say all that to say that one of the earliest revivals that we have history of is where the altar kind of came into play, where people began to come to the altar. And the reason that they came to the altar in this respect of this platform, so to speak, was to, they called laying it all down. They came to lay it all down. And they had this belief that in prior times they were taught it would take several years for God to remove, say, a heavy burden or to sanctify you. And we all know it takes years to sanctify us. That's not the point. But they had this understanding, if we could come to the altar and receive from the Holy Spirit, that in a moment of time the Spirit could indwell us. And as a Spirit would indwell, it would give you the power to be a witness, but it would also do a sanctifying work in your heart. Sanctifying meaning cleaning up all the junk. And so many times when we come out from the world that we live in, and when we come into the walls of a sanctuary, we begin to feel the cleanliness of God's presence. And maybe sometimes we don't know what to do with it. That's what the altar's for. The altar's to come and say, God, I recognize that I am a sinner, that I do have some of the residue. James talks about keeping ourselves unstained by the world, right? And the altar becomes a place where we bring our stain and we just lay it here and say, Jesus, I lay it all down. And what I receive from you is the fullness of your Spirit. God is so good. We sang that first song that His love can change the world. You know, many singers throughout the secular realm and the Christian realm have sang, we believe in love, right? They don't know what else they believe in, but at the end of the day, we believe in love. Well, we believe in God's love. God's love, which is pure, which is powerful, which can penetrate any darkness whatsoever. And so I just want to let you know that as we continue to worship, don't feel inhibited by the pew that's in front of you. If you desire more of God, if you're a student, you're a young person, you're not so young anymore, but you're young in your heart, whatever, there's no restriction. Would you just come and lay it all down, as they used to say in days of old. And as you lay it all down, as you die to your flesh, as you let go of self-sufficiency, what do you open yourself up for? The fullness of God to come in and to be your Lord in every way. So that's my message.
I will worship
with all of my heart.
With all
bow down. I will bow down.
I will bow down.
Will you ask me?
Will you ask me?
I will serve you.
Sovereign still in the moment.
a God in heaven, and here am I on earth. So I'll let my words be few. Jesus, I am so simplest of all love songs, I want to bring to you. So I'll let my words be few. Jesus,
stand in awe of God. The word that goes with that word of awesome. Awesome is the word that describes God. It's a very limited word to describe an infinite God, but it's kind of the best we have to say that he's awesome and then to stand breathless before him because you just really don't know how to respond to one so beautiful, one so capable, one so holy. So we just stand in awe of him. And I just invite you to do that now. Just be in awe of your God. He's holy, he's righteous, he's true. He's infinite and powerful and sovereign and mighty. And what he says is what will be. He's been given all authority in heaven and in earth. And at his name, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess because he's awesome. The things that are awesome in our life are what get elevated the highest in the terms of our worship. If our problems are awesome, then they take the place of the throne that is intended for an awesome God. If our worries and our cares are awesome, they take the place intended for an awesome God's throne. And I want to invite you to just take your awesome cares and worries, and I don't in any way, not even for a moment,
think lowly of those things or as if they don't exist, because I know I have them in my life. We, in this world, we have tribulation, Jesus said. But he said, be of good cheer because I'm awesome. I've overcome the world. And I want to invite you just to lay down the cares that you have, the cares of this world, the worries and concerns, and for a moment, just place them at the foot of an awesome God. Just offload now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. It's the time in Scripture when Jesus says that he's gentle when he talks about this exchange, and he says this burden and this yoke is easy and light. He tells us to learn of him. He doesn't hold us at fault for this. He doesn't go, oh, look at these weak people. He looks at his sons and daughters and says, if you'd just ask, I could help. But I've chosen to limit myself to your asking because I want to be wanted by you. It has to be your choice. So God, we declare we want you. God, we declare we need you. That we're desperate. That on our own we make a mess of our life. But God, you're a redeemer. And you're so good. God, minister to your people. Pour out your spirit to them. Although this Holy Spirit can be mysterious to us because we don't understand everything, it's very clear from Scripture that the Holy Spirit comes to minister life to you. Jesus explained it as wells or springs of living water that flow endlessly. Refreshment so that you can refresh others. God, I just pray you'd pour that into your people today. We are thirsty. We're hungry. And only you satisfy. Maybe some of you could acknowledge, or maybe a guest, or what, I don't know, maybe you've been here a few times, maybe you can acknowledge you've looked after other things to satisfy and it's not working for you. Make it your prayer and your confession before God that only he can satisfy, and then open your heart wide to him. It's the good news. It's the good news that as you open yourself to him, he fills you. I wonder if we could sing that again. I stand in awe of you, and just be aware of the awesome presence of God. And you know what? You let God do whatever God wants to do. Just let him do whatever he wants to do. Maybe he just wants to encourage you or strengthen you. Who knows? But just give him his rightful place. Surrender to him.
And I'll stand in awe. So
Would you just express your love to God? Just speak it out. Just declare your love. God, we honor you, Lord. Father, we open our hearts wide to your word. Your word that transforms, God, that works in conjunction with your spirit. It's the full package, God. We want all of you. Lord, come now. Come and meet your people, even on a deeper level. That it is you plow the territory of our heart, God, and you soften the soil surrounding the areas that need seeds to be sown, that the seed would find the target today. Lord, help us in those areas where we're dying to come alive, God. Help us in those areas where we just lack the faith to live again, to be ignited today by the power of your spirit and the authority of your word to come alive, God. And no more will we stand for lifelessness and the ripoff that the enemy comes to destroy and to lie to us all day long. But that you would bring to us the reality of your word, of the finished work on the cross, of the victory that comes through your power and your might, of the awesomeness of our God. Let it come alive in us today, we pray. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. 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 Oh, we're going to continue on in the same heart, and I'll invite you to be seated this morning. And as we invite our ushers to come and receive the offering, if you could. And boy, God is awesome, isn't he? Yeah. Amy, will you stay up here for just 1 second? Because you can... Don't you love Amy? Isn't Amy wonderful? It's an important time of year. We don't generally just put buckets with scarecrows in the front of the church. So would you just explain what's going on, Amy? And yeah.
The harvest fair is coming. It'll be Sunday. Yay, I know. It's exciting. Sunday, October 31st from 6 to 9, Sunday night. So we have a bit of a challenge. time-wise, because we're going to be in church. So I just wanted to encourage you to volunteer. I need lots of volunteers. We, of course, need lots of candy. If you can bring individually wrapped bags of candy and put it in that bucket there. And also, if you go out this door here, you'll see there's an A-frame sign, and it has all of the booths, and I need them all full. So if you could sign up, I'm just asking for an hour of your time that night. And I have also on the other side, there's a sign up for setup crew, tear down crew, and a couple of donations that if you are interested in bringing like pumpkins and that kind of stuff. One thing that we're adding this year that will be kind of fun is a family pumpkin carving contest. So if you want to sign up for that for your family, that would be really fun. But nothing scary. It's all just festive, okay? So I look forward to seeing your name on the list. Thank you.
Right on. Thank you, Amy. You know, it's an exciting time of year. We've been doing this for well over 20 years, and the community knows about it. It's a great opportunity for us just to be around those that may not know Christ, and as they go from booth to booth, just to be a good reflection of Jesus. So it's an outreach. It's a what oftentimes is termed as friendship evangelism, where you get to know people and you maybe connect with them. So if you're part of our church and you go, you can't be rude, discourteous, mean, jerky, or anything like that. You have to be like super nice. And live out the Jesus that's inside of you. So if someone steps on your foot or cuts in line, you have to go, oh, no problem. I prefer you. So anyways, I know you would anyway. Hey, let me bless the offering. So Jesus, we thank you for the privilege it is to serve you, God, and to worship you in the way that we can give. Lord, we can give our worship and our honor and our songs, but Lord, that we can give a part of ourselves in terms of the provision you've given us, Lord, according to your word, we joyfully give it back to you. And we thank you, God, that you've been so faithful. Lord, I just stand as a witness of your faithfulness in this church, God, you've provided in my own life. And you're faithful to your word. So bless your people, God. Bless the ones who can give and the ones that can't today, Lord. I pray you would just let your grace abound to them richly today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, as the ushers take that offering today, or don't take it, guys, as they receive it, I did want to also mention that on next Friday, the 15th, we have a special night of worship. And many of you know, and I mentioned this last week, but I'll just say it again, but Irene Marin and Thompson and her husband, Vaughn, they're going to just bring a big band. It's going to be loud and exciting and going for it. They have several churches that they're connected with, and so it's a chance for us all to get together and worship the Lord. So there is childcare provided. There's a flyer in the bulletin, so check it out. We'd love to have you. The details are all in there. Am I missing anything that I should say? Okay, so check out the flyer, and these guys are awesome. How many of you have ever heard Irene or Vaughn lead worship before? Man, they just have such a gift, and so you'll want to be here for that. Also, you might have seen the announcement. I don't know if you're able to put that back up, but I just want to get those details out. Many of you might remember Nick Lowe, and Nick was around the church for many years, and he relocated to Riverside. Nick passed away, and it's a very sad thing. He's a young man. There's the details of his memorial service, but I wish I had a picture for those of you that might not put a name with a face. But one thing that you can always remember about Nick is he was always smiling, and he had this really great, deep, goofy laugh, and he was always laughing. He was just filled with the joy of the Lord. And he had complications and when he was having a heart surgery and suffered a major heart attack. But, you know, I was thinking about Nick this morning and telling you that he passed away and giving you these details and just thinking about the joy that he had on earth pales in comparison to the joy that he is experiencing now with the Lord. It really helped me catch a picture. If he was that happy here, imagine how goofy he is laughing up there in heaven now just with Jesus. And so if you knew Nick or if you wanted to show support, the details are there. We can get him if you call the church office. And that's it. And the final thing is just don't forget today after the service, we do have our annual business meeting. Some of you are asking, if you're not a member of the church, can you go to the lunch? No, sorry. No, I'm kidding. Yes. If you're not a member, please come. It's an opportunity for us to report back on our stewardship. How have we spent our finances this year? We have our books are wide open. It's the policy of our church. We are, here you go. You want to see what we've done? You can look at everything. There's nothing hidden. And it's an opportunity to do that and also to bring in our new deacons for the year and then just fellowship together, hear reports from the staff and so forth. So if you're a member, you take part in the voting process. If you're not, you just hang out and listen to everything, okay? So please come. There's spaghetti. Nina cooked it. So Nina, thank you. As we open up God's word this morning, I'd like you to turn to Revelation chapter 3. I began talking about this last week, and as I prepared this week for the message, I thought, you know, I just really wasn't able to give that justice. And I wanted to go back to that portion of scripture and talk to us a little bit more out of Revelation chapter 3 and hopefully open this up a little bit more for us. If you were with us, you'll remember we've been on this idea or series, so to speak, of keeping our focus, keeping our heart in a place where we're compassionate for the lost, where not only do we feel like compassion for somebody who may not know Jesus, but that we literally pray and believe that we would receive God's heart for the one that's lost. And when we pray that prayer, I brought before you the fact that it's pretty dangerous to pray that way because God just might answer that. He might give you a love for somebody that prior to that prayer was really unlovely. He might give you a heart and a compassion for somebody that you just couldn't stand. Why? Because you begin to see them the way that God sees them. And that's the whole point of our Christian faith, is that we would connect with receiving salvation ourselves, receiving the good news, walking in the victory of what Jesus came to do, but that we wouldn't just sort of hang out in that good, happy place, but that we would be a part of the mission of God on this earth to share his good news with all who need to know him. And there are many that need to know him. And so it's maybe a shift in our thinking of who might deserve salvation and who might be a good candidate to be saved. Many of you have probably had this experience, but the people that you think are so close to salvation are often not. And the one that you think is so far away that I don't even bother telling them the story, I'm not even going to bother sharing the gospel, they're like right there. And so we have to have the mind of Christ to be able to sow that seed. I love the parable of the sower and the parable of the sower, where it was just like, just sow it. You know, you get the idea of sowing seed is just put the word out there and trust in the soil preparation of the Holy Spirit that if you don't throw the seed, it won't get deposited. And so that's been the message. And in getting into the place where we can receive the heart of God, I think an important thing is that we would pack lightly. That's what the message was last week, that we would pack lightly, that we don't take on extra stuff that weigh us down and bog us down. We wouldn't take on extra possessions, extra ideas, things that keep us attached. As that parable I just referred to, it's in, I believe I wrote it in my notes, I think it's Matthew 10. Anyways, look it up yourself. In that parable, it's in the Bible, you know it is. One of the things that choked out the word of God, if you'll remember, was the cares of this world. The cares of this world. And so if you put the connection together, if you want the word of God to be vibrant and alive in you so that it can be alive in others, you have to mind the cares of this world. Because as you start packing on the cares of this world, the word of God gets choked out. And many of you can attest to that. You could say, yeah, I know. There's been seasons in my life where I've been off track, where I've cared far too much about things that weren't important. Getting that thing that I needed. You know, we hit on this and kind of pry into this in our Orange County mentality. We're pretty into our stuff, you know, and so we have to, as people living in this particular society, we have to be aware that that things can sometimes own us versus us owning the thing, right? And so keeping that stuff in check before God, that we pack lightly so that we can do the will and the work of God. I had an interesting thing happen this morning. I checked my email, and you might remember Andy and Donella Seckerly. They were part of this church years ago, and they relocated out of state. And Donella had just written me an email, and she said, I couldn't sleep last night. And so I was going through, and I was looking online, and I found the church, and so I listened to the message last week. And she said that, she goes, then I realized why I couldn't sleep, that at our dinner table the night before, we had been talking about packing light, and the very verses that were read were things that we were discussing as a family, and how God used that to confirm what he's doing. And I only share that to share that when we are seeking the Lord and delivering a message, it's the heart of God. I'm not saying that any one of us that preach are infallible, and we can really, I mean, you could probably attest to that. We can blow it sometimes and miss the mark in preaching and teaching. But when God confirms that he's saying something, that the same God who speaks in California is speaking in the south of the country, and he's saying something to his people, and that's to keep your focus. Keep your focus. I love that song. Couldn't be a better set of songs today. None but Jesus. And then just stand in awe of him. And in order to do that, we got to unpack stuff. Another thing that, well, I'll skip that. I'll maybe come back to it later. Revelation chapter 3. Let's get into the Bible today. And I do have to mention that today is Ruth Ann's birthday. And also Josefina's birthday. I think she's probably teaching in the Sunday school. But happy birthday to you, Ruth Ann. We sure love you. I'll get in trouble, but it was Ron's birthday yesterday. It's probably many other people. Raise your hand if it was your birthday in the last couple of days. All right, well, happy birthday to all of you if I've missed it. So anyways.
Happy birthday.
Oh, thank you. I was waiting for that. All right. Okay, so Revelation chapter 3, verse 14. And this is what we read last week, and let's expound on it a little more. It says, the angel of the Lord in Laodicea write these words, of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither hot nor cold. And I wish that you were one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I'm rich and I've acquired great wealth and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you're wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. How many of you are feeling encouraged? Verse 18, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so that you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so that you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so that you can see. And those whom I love, I rebuke and I discipline, so be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and I knock. And if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him, and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I have overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. And he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. This portion of scripture is written to a group of people, a specific church in a specific region. And you might remember last week, we talked about that metaphor of the drink being hot or cold. And we're going to get back to that because I want to hopefully develop that a little bit more. But I want to explain to you maybe something that might allow this to come alive a little bit. The first part, when Jesus is talking about these things, and he talks about in verse 14, in the second part, he says, these are the words of the Amen. The first thing that he talks about is his own character. And it's as though he's preparing the reader for what he's about to say. Before you even listen to what I say, Jesus is saying, I am the Amen. What does that mean? What's the Amen? It's I'm the so be it. I'm the ultimate authority that when my words are spoken, they are. You remember in John where it says, verily, verily, right? Scholars call that the double amen. Doesn't that sound cool? The double amen. The double amen is like, really, really. Amen, amen, so be it. When Jesus says it, verily, verily, he says, unless you're born again, you can't see the kingdom of God. He says it another time in John as well. But Jesus says of himself, I'm sovereign. I'm sovereign. And you know, when you sing a worship song like I Stand in Awe of You, and you have that understanding that what Jesus says is, it helps you to go, wow, I stand in awe of you. You're awesome. Whatever you say is yes and amen. Whatever you say is truth. And so before we even unpack the message, we believe that whatever he's going to say is truth. Whatever this word says, the written words of Jesus, they're truth. They're amen. They're amen. He's sovereign. And then he goes even deeper as he's explaining himself. He says, the faithful and true witness. The faithful and true witness. Now, I doubt that any one of us have a question mark in our mind if Jesus is the faithful and true witness. But it presupposes that there are false witnesses, right? And as you go into the book of Revelation a little more, you see that there is. There's those that come to lead people astray. But it's like the worship song, none but Jesus. I'm the true witness. I'm the faithful one. What I say is absolute truth. I go back to this passage in my life over and over again, and I'll drop this in your lap, that no matter what it is in our life, whether it's seeking guidance, whether it's our concerns or our cares for loved ones, that if we'll seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all these things will be added. Why? Because he's the true witness. He's the true way. When he says that claim, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, that's it. It's exclusive. And there's such comfort in that. And how many of you have done what I've done before, where we seek after other things, right? We seek after good solutions to our problems. And I don't understand this about the mystery of God, but somehow, when I just love and worship him, when I get my gaze fixed on him, when I just do what he says, even if what he says has nothing to do with what I need in my life, meaning he just says, I want you to obey me over here. And then somehow, in the cosmic scheme of godliness, over here gets taken care of, right? That's the seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's the packing lightly. That's the focus of none but Jesus. God help us to shed this stuff. All the things that get us going in the wrong direction. You know, if you've ever read Screwtape Letters by C.S. Lewis, what a great book. And in there, he talks about sort of the enemy's plan to get us all busy. If we could just get busy, and especially if we can get busy doing spiritual things and get our focus off of Jesus, we are completely lost. We live in this thought process that, well, at least I'm volunteering at the church, right? At least I'm doing good stuff. I'm helping out these people. I'm doing the work. And what Jesus is saying, all I want you to do is fix your gaze on me. And as your gaze is fixed on me, I'm the one who empowers you. I'm the source of life. And then I give you steps of obedience that bring about fruitfulness. Do you go back to last week, one of the things we talked about was when Jesus sent out the 12 in Matthew 10. And do you remember he says, go out, this is where I want you to go. Don't go to these guys, go to these guys. And then he says, just go ahead and cast out demons and heal the sick. You remember this? Heal the sick, cast out demons. If they don't like your message, shake the dust off and move on to the next guy. Now, put yourself in the shoes of the disciples. If I was to come to you and say, hey, let's, not that I'm Jesus, but I'm just saying, let's, for the sake of the thing, go to the door. We're going to go door to door. And what I want you to do is we go door to door, just knock on the door, cast out demons, and heal the sick. That's your instructions. We all get together, we rally, we join hands in a circle, we sing two worship songs, we pray, and let's go. Knock on doors. And by the way, don't take a bunch of stuff. Don't take extra, all your library of to-do books or whatever else. But just go with me and the anointing of that I've given you and go ahead and cast out demons and heal the sick. How would you feel? I mean, I know like the really spiritual among us would say, yeah, let's go, let's do this, right? But the average one of us is like, really, how? How do I do that? What does that look like? Knock, knock, knock. Yes, we're from the church down the street and we're here to cast out demons. You got any demon problems in the house? kind of like that for the disciples. What they realized was that if I'm going to do what Jesus, the ultimate authority, the Amen, wants me to do, I need him to do it through me. It's the impossible task. You've been called to the impossible task. And the more that you strive to do it, and I strive to do it on my own, the more that I fail miserably. And I end up going, what do I do? What am I doing wrong? How do I do this? Now, whether it's the literal casting out of demons and the literal healing, or just simply the impossible task of obedience to God, impossible meaning in your own ability, you have to even be empowered by the Holy Spirit to obey God. What a comfort that is, you know? It even gives you the stuff to obey him if you'll just yield and make it none but Jesus. So whether it's the literal work that he called the disciples to or the specific things he's called you to, the idea is this. It's real simple. Pack light. Don't take on the extra stuff. Unlearn some things and get your eyes just fixed on Jesus. Seek first the kingdom, his righteousness, and all these things will be added. And then he says, back in Revelation, he says, I'm the true witness. And then he says, the ruler of God's creation. That's important. It's important. He's painting the whole package. He's not just saying, I'm Jesus, independent of the Trinity. He's saying, hey, the Father, Son, and the Spirit, we're all together one in this thing. And I was there in creation. And as we read in Colossians, you can look it up on your own. I don't want to get us off track. But I think you need to have some of this in your repertoire, so to speak, that you know what it says about his character and nature. Colossians 1:15. I'm going to read it. You can turn there if you want. It says, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. Listen to this. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones, powers, or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. For he is before all things, and in him he holds all things together. He's the head of the body. He's the church. He's the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that he might have the supremacy in everything. That's Jesus. I know I just spit out a mouthful of words, but if you would look at that in your own scripture, if you would take a minute to just sit in awe of who God is. In fact, what better of a time than right now? You just stop for a minute, stop it all, and just think about the authority of Jesus. Just think of the awe of a God who is Amen. He is it. He is the so be it. He is the true witness. He is the ultimate authority over your life and over all of creation. Could you just take a minute, and it might even take you to close your eyes, and just soak in who Jesus is. Just soak him in. Psalms has what's called a Selah, where you just pause for effect. Let's just take one right now. Jesus, I pray that even more, especially more than my own words, but your words of truth would penetrate any wall of darkness in our life. That in a moment like this, in a church meeting, that we would just sit and stand and kneel and however our expression, in awe of you and receive the truth of your word, that you're sovereign, that you're the true witness, and that you're over all things. And would you let that become a comfort to us in our heaviness, in our weariness? Or would you let that penetrate the powers of darkness that bring lies to us? Would you let that revelation run deep in our hearts this morning? Can I just ask you to do this? Just receive the fullness of Jesus in your life. That means when you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, it doesn't just say seek first God. It says his kingdom that Jesus came to bring. That means that he's in charge. And so would you just take a moment, however you want to do, and surrender yourself before God and say, Jesus, I put you in charge. Put you in your rightful place in the throne of my heart. Yeah. Amen. As you look back into the passage now, and what I just had you do is basically what I believe Jesus was doing in that letter. He was explaining who he was. He was getting their hearts set for what he wanted to say. I'm going to put this map up because I want you to get a geographical understanding of this region of Laodicea. It's in modern-day Turkey. And if you look on the map, there's a couple of spots that are kind of important to this church's existence. Above it, you see Laodicea there. I wish I had one of those pointer things, but if you look at right over there, there's a star that says Laodicea. And above it, there's a place called Hierapolis, and below it, there's a place called Colossae. And if you don't see it, they kind of go Hierapolis here, Laodicea here, and Colossae underneath. They're kind of they're in the same region, within probably walking distance from one another. And the reason that I show you this map is to show you that it's a real place in a real time that a real letter was written, right? And then the place above Laodicea called Hierapolis was a place known for hot springs. And this isn't just a speculation. In fact, if you could show the next picture, those are the hot springs. And the picture is really cool because you see like Roman columns that are in there and stuff like that. We had a chance to go to Turkey and we got to see some of this stuff. My friend got married there and we had a chance to witness some of the stuff firsthand. But I mean, imagine how many years that is old. And I really blessed you this morning by not showing you the picture with European tourists in that pool receiving the healing of the waters. But it's a natural hot spring. And that in that natural hot spring, people would go because they it had therapeutic value to them, right? They could go and they could sit in those hot springs. And some of the minerals that are there that they've tested, they really believe had some physical benefit. And some people even attached a mystical thing to it where they thought, all right, we could sit in this and we would get healed and everything would be good. Outside of Christianity, I'm talking, they just thought we go in there and do this and we get healed. I don't know. But that was Hierapolis, hot water. Okay, and then maybe you could show the next picture. You still see that people today, that was a version of a picture so you didn't have to see someone in a bathing suit on a Sunday morning. But I show you this to say that people today even go to Hierapolis and put their feet in the water just to kind of get the therapy of the warm water. And then the next picture, this is a picture of Colossae, and that's not hot water. That's fast-moving, cool, refreshing water. Okay, now, Hierapolis, hot water. I mean, good, hot mineral water. Colossae, cold, refreshing water. Where's Laodicea? Remember the map? Right in the middle. Isn't that amazing how Jesus now is writing this letter through John to these people and he's saying, okay, I know what you're about. I know your deeds. You're not hot like Hierapolis and you're not cool like Colossae. But in fact, you're right in the middle. And what archaeology also has pointed out is there's a canal that runs from Hierapolis right into Laodicea. And that canal, it basically pipes the water in for drinking. But unfortunately, by the time that the water gets to Laodicea, what is it? It's all tepid and nasty. And when you and it's even said in some other historical writings that, you know, people would take a drink of it, it's like, pugh, you spit it out. It's the feeling that you get when you took the coffee that was from yesterday that might have still been left. It's totally acclimated to its environment. It's become lukewarm and it's become disgusting, right? And so that's the imagery that Jesus was talking about. And that's what we read into and in this drink metaphor. He says, I know your deeds, that you're neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were one or the other, but because you're lukewarm, neither hot or cold, I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. And then he goes on and he talks about, you say that I'm rich and I've acquired wealth and I do not need a thing, but you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, naked, and blind. Another thing that you need to know about Laodicea is that they weren't poor, wretched, and maybe they were in the spirit, but in the physical, they certainly were not poor. They had a thriving wool trade that was there. They had good wool. Everybody would come for it. In fact, it allowed them to acquire so much wealth that 35 years prior to this letter being written, the whole place was destroyed by an earthquake and they had enough money to build it back up. They were self-sufficient. They had everything they needed. They had all the money they needed. In fact, they had this great clothes that they could clothe themselves with. Their clothes were so nice that other people would come to seek these particular clothes. And then it goes even further into this thing. He says, you're poor, you're blind, and you're naked. There was a known fact that there was a medical school in Laodicea. And the medical school produced a salve. And it, remember it says, I encourage you, you get this salve. And where are you guys going? I'm just kidding. I just did that because, no, I know where they're going.
They're going to prepare the meal, and God bless you both. Thank you, Jan and Meg. You guys are thinking it. You can watch it on video later. Thank you. We love you. Okay. Bye-bye, Nina. We'll see you in there, too. Okay, so this medical school produced the salve, and the salve was known to treat all the illnesses, Middle Eastern type illnesses that would come from the environment, that they could rub this stuff, because that was the area they were in, right? They could rub this stuff on their eyes, and they would treat whatever, a sty or whatever the particular thing that it was. What's the point of all this? Am I just trying to throw at you some really interesting history? No, I'm trying to paint you a picture. Think about the original reader of this letter, what they were being told. Jesus was saying to them, be very, very careful. Be very careful, because the deal is, you think one thing about yourself, but something else is really true. Your physical reality shows you that you're just fine in terms of your finances, that you got all that you need to cover yourself in clothing, that you even have this really cool salve that you can put on your eye, so you're famous for this stuff. Everybody comes to you for it. But guess what? You remember your water issue? Don't get so high and mighty. Remember your water issue? That when they drink your water, they want to spit it out. Because you've developed this idea that you've become just like the world that you live in. And this is the point. This is the point that I wanted to drive home to you last week. The point that's burning in my own heart is, God help us. God help us that when he calls us to do things, that we do it his way. Because if we don't do it his way, all that we do is on our own strength and our own self-sufficiency, we try to do the work of God. That we become acclimated. We become totally acclimated to the world that we live in, and we become just completely infused with the cares of this world. And that's what this letter addresses. But there's good news in this letter. It doesn't just stay there just to kind of hound you. As I said last week, this preaches real well if you just want to throw down and say, hey, how many lukewarm ones are out there? You know, probably all of us who are really desiring to follow God, we're concerned about this in our own spiritual life. We look over things and go, God, I want to just be more on fire for you. I want to be either refreshing to people that the expression of my Christian life brings refreshment, a cup of cold water to someone, or I want to be therapeutic in terms of, I want that the reflection of my life brings a warmth and a healing to people. But God, I just fear that sometimes I'm right there in the middle and I don't know if I'm doing what I should be doing. And I'm not going to ask you for a show of hands, because I already know when I talk to people, when I even reflect in my own life, I realize, we always think we're not doing good enough. I read a statistic about pastors, and it said, my sister gave me this article about the health and well-being of pastors, and it said that 82% of pastors struggle with this off-the-charts amount of guilt, thinking that they're never doing enough. And I wouldn't say that that's just for pastors. I would say that's probably for anyone with a heart to follow after God. You just struggle and you're not doing enough. I don't think that's what it was being addressed here in Revelation. I think what's being addressed is, you can do this, guys. There is hope. Because you remember what Jesus says? And hear me on this. He says, I stand at the door of your heart and I knock. And if anyone would let me in, I'd come in. What is Jesus? He's healing to the water. Okay, second law of thermodynamics. If you don't have something making the water hot or cold, it's going to get completely just bleh, right? That's an abbreviated version of that for all you scientists who are like, what? You have to have a force that makes your water either cold or hot, right? If you don't plug in the refrigerator, your food gets nasty. You know, if the microwave doesn't do its job through electricity, you can't heat it up. Point of this is, when he's saying, I stand at the door and I knock, it's like, I'm here. If you will let me in, I'll make your water cold and I'll make your water hot. I'll make the expression of your life different than this world, so that when people look at Christians, they don't go, puh! So that when people hear our message, they're not, oh, you're disgusting. Now, are you going to have issues with people who are just God haters? Yes, scripture says it, that there will come in the last days those that just really hate God and hate you with it. And Jesus promised you're going to be persecuted and reviled and all this kind of stuff. But wouldn't you want to make sure you're fueled with God? If you know that's going to happen, why would we want to add to it through any kind of lukewarm living? Does that make sense? We're a peculiar people. That's what scripture says. Let's not add to our peculiarness by our own doing. But let's let the healing of Jesus come into our own waters and give us that expression where we can offer a cup of cold water, we can offer a warm drink, but what we certainly aren't giving to people through our example or our message is
tepid, lukewarm nastiness. And so as he says, he stands at the door and he knocks. It gives you a really vivid imagery. And I want you to maybe think about this for a minute. Is Jesus inside the doors of our church, or is he outside going, hey, let me in? Is Jesus inside the doors of your heart, or is he outside going, let me in? We use this, and we should. I mean, it's good. It's a good message for salvation. But if he's saying that he's outside, I can't imagine that the very body of Christ, that the very one who Scripture says he's our head, right? We are like possibly in some ways a headless church just going, oh, what happens when you cut the head off of a chicken, right? If you've ever grown up on a farm, blah, they go crazy. Head falls off. And this is gross, but it's true. If you've ever seen it, they run around aimlessly, and it's not a pretty sight. I think that what God is calling us to in these days is to allow him to come in and heal our waters, to respond to the knock that is on the door of our heart. And the main way I believe that we do it is through laying down our self-sufficiency, through acknowledging the fact, like, I really am naked without you, God. I really am poor. Yeah, I might, and I thank you for it, God. I might have money in the bank, and that's not evil. And I might have nice clothes, and that's not evil. And I might have a car to drive, and that's not evil. But God, if I ever rely upon that, if I ever rely upon the fact that, at least I've got my house if everything else goes downhill, or at least I can show up with clothes on. Do you hear what I'm saying? Where is our reliance upon? Is it upon the stuff? Or is it upon the one who gives us the stuff? It's the same message given in a different way. And until I feel released, I'm going to continue just to bring it to us over and over again, because I think it's what the Spirit of God is saying to the church today. He's saying it to me. He's saying it to you. He's saying it to people that are in other states. You know, we've got to be mindful of where we find our hope. I want to give you this last, I want to kind of revisit one thing in these last couple of minutes. I'm not gonna. Never mind. Next week I'll revisit this last thing in a couple of minutes. Yeah, it's just gonna take too long to do it. Okay, well, here's the deal. Self-sufficiency and pride are the temperature of lukewarmness, right? That is, if you want to connect something with what is lukewarm, that when people hear your message as a Christian, and if you got it all together in terms of you're a know-it-all, or and hear me when I'm saying that, I am not saying that you've got to embrace all kinds of wild philosophies and ideas. I loved this last Truth Project when he said that when you begin to oppose the truth, that one of the things that people who are preaching a lie will make you out to be evil, you know, that the ultimate, they're first you're ignorant, you know, and then it goes on through a list, and ultimately you're evil, okay? That's just a common tactic and a ploy of the enemy to make you feel dumb. I'm saying that you can't rely upon yourself, your own talents, abilities, skills, and stuff. That's the stuff of lukewarm temperature. Pride. Pride is the big killer. Pride is the thing that gets you to try to do God's work your way. And there is nothing nastier than that. There is nothing more foul to the world that when they see, say, a prideful Christian come and just throw down out of pride, using the word of God to be their platform. It's like speaking truth through, I don't even know where I'm going with that. But do you get what I'm saying? Because it's kind of a slippery slope. I don't want you to be preaching the wrong message. Do you speak truth? Yes. Do you speak it with passion? Yes. Do you oppose lies? Yes. But you do it from a standpoint of being refreshed and renewed by Jesus. You have to do things Jesus' way. 1 Peter 3. Jesus' way. Romans 12, Jesus' way. The Beatitudes, Jesus' way. What do these things all do? All of those verses I just said remove your ability to get revenge on people. It calls you to bless those who curse you. It calls you to do that, to love those who hate you, to pray for your enemy. That's the hard stuff of Christianity. And what I think it's masterful, right? Because Jesus knows that if we'll do that, we have got to be humble. We have got to rely upon him. I cannot love somebody who hates me without Jesus. Who could? I cannot bless my enemy without Jesus. Who could? And be very, very careful in these days that when somebody comes to speak against you or your message, that you're not guilty of the prideful sin of revenge. Because the minute that you put, whether it's revenge through your words or through your actions, maybe I will go there. That's the connecting point that I think I threw out there a few weeks ago, this burning of the Quran thing. And I made a statement that I said, I don't think that was at all godly. But I want to connect the dots. I understand. I understand this passion and this zeal against things that are opposing. And even as an American, I understand the dynamics of things happening and the building of mosques and the stirring of the pot. I get that. I get a message that can be oppressive and a message that can be harmful and demonic. I get all of that. I don't want you to think that I don't get that. But what I understand is what Jesus says and what Peter says, that if we take revenge through an action like burning somebody else's, we just eliminate Jesus. We're not doing Jesus things Jesus' way. That's the message. The message is we've got to do the right things. Heal the sick. Raise the dead. Cast out demons. But we can't do it pridefully. We can't do it self-sufficiently. Because the moment that we do, we are lukewarm. And Jesus left the building. Literally. And then he comes back and says, hey, whenever you're ready, I'll come back in and then I'll be in charge. Do you hear my heart? These are trying times. These are passionate times. But these are times that, like never before, we're called to humility. We're called to obedience. And I encourage you, I didn't have a chance or time to read it, but I really encourage you to please meditate on Romans chapter 12, the latter half especially, to meditate on 1 Peter chapter 3, to read through again the Beatitudes, to understand the heart of the believer, the heart of the one who does things Jesus' way. It's very challenging. So challenging that when I was preparing this, I was kind of getting on my high horse thinking, yeah, I'm doing a pretty good job at this. And you know what? Just in an instant, the Holy Spirit said, yeah, but what about the way you're acting towards that one person? Oh, really? Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord. Realizing the amount of words that I had said that were negative and the amount of justification. We're talking that I think that the issue that I had in my mind that the Holy Spirit was convicting me on, it was a righteous issue. But you can't I see it like this. The moment that you handle what you think is righteousness unrighteously or through pride, that's revenge. And Jesus left the building. But the moment that you're able to take the one who's wronged you or to take the people group or whoever who's wronged you, hold them before the throne and say, God, I bless those who curse me. God, I will walk in the truth and I will speak the truth. And even if those very ones want to take my life, that I will stand for truth. And I'll do it according to your word and your way. Then God will so honor that. You can read about it throughout history. He's honored. I can get off my soapbox now. Let's stand together. God, I just want to thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us. I want to thank you for this reminder in Revelation. That there is fresh water that comes from you. It's cold and it's refreshing to people. And that there is hot water that comes from you, that it's therapeutic and healing. And that you desire, that the expression that your church, your bride has, is one or the other. But you certainly don't want us to be lukewarm. And in our lukewarm state, we get there because we get self-sufficient. We get there because we think we're rich and clothed and healthy and whatever else. But our dependence is upon physical things and not spiritual things. When you've called us, Lord, to something so much deeper. You've called us to a radical humility and dependence upon you and you alone. And so, Lord, as your bride, as your church, I pray that today we wouldn't be a chicken with its head cut off, but we would be a unified body of believers who believe in you and who belong to you and to one another and who behave according to what you've called us to do. Help us, God, in these days to model your word and your ways. To not walk in revenge, because you know the moment, Lord, that we walk in revenge, we remove your ability to judge righteously because we've taken it into our own hands. I want to say that God is in this, the God that we read about in Revelation, I want you to hear this. He is the Amen. He's in charge, and vengeance belongs to him. He will repay and he will judge. He will judge according to his righteousness. And so God, would you free us of the responsibility to do that according to our own righteousness? Fill us afresh and anew with your Holy Spirit, God, I pray. Bless your people. Lord, I pray you'd bless them with hope. You'd strengthen and encourage them. And I praise you, God, for all your goodness. In the name of Jesus, Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. And please come and join us for round two.